standing on stage at the Obal Foundation Graduate Hall as guest speaker at this year's Speech and Prize Giving Ceremony. And it sits within me the trial of fulfillment, pride, and above all, appreciation for the opportunities I have been blessed with from my days here as a student and thereafter. Sitting to the right of this hall as a middle school prefect, sometime around 1997 or thereabouts, I was engulfed, still and captivated, listening to the late Chief James Ajibola Ike, SAN, whose rhetorical prowess rightly earned him the title of Cicero, deliver a very inspirational and deeply intuitive speech at the prize-giving day ceremony of that year. I still remember with glee the charge given to us that day when Nigeria was still under the firm grip of military dictatorship by the late Cicero, who then was also the Baba Oba of Enugu Ijesha. And this was what he told us. He said, "The darkness generated by a congregation of a million evil people cannot do as much as put out the light of a single candle." On that blessed and decisive day, I thought to myself that, God willing, I will one day merit an invitation as guest speaker at a prize-giving day ceremony. Coincidentally, Chief Bola Ige spoke here in 1997 as a senior advocate of Nigeria, and today, to the eternal glory of God, at a few years over half the age that the late genius chief was in 1997, I stand before you all. Peers with a demand to do more. Your parents and family members must be very proud of you. Your individual successes that are being celebrated today are direct fallouts of the limitless opportunities that OIS provides. I'm also a beneficiary, and indeed, proudly, as one of the first students to populate OIS when its doors opened for service on 9th January 1994, I'm one of the first set of beneficiaries of and from this theater of dreams. I'm very sorry. I could not resist the temptation of referring to the pseudonym name of my favorite football club, Manchester United FC. Ladies and gentlemen, appropriately so, who would have thought that a football team originally made up of railway workers, they played on a field strewn with mud and gravel. They felt they were not good enough for the professional league. Finished at the bottom of the league, in their first 2 years, they were relegated. They atrociously lost games with score lines like 14-0, 9-0, and they were close to going extinct due to debt. Who would have thought that today that club is one of the most successful, biggest, and wealthiest football club in the world? Permission to digress a little bit and share a personal experience. It's important to mention that my admiration for Manchester United was fertilized on the grounds of OIS. And I remember vividly, as if it just occurred yesterday, watching the Champions League finals that was played in Camp Nou in Barcelona at the OIS Principal's Lodge just there, with the founding principal, Dr. D.F. Borges, a man I must mention, is a man of limitless capacity to think and a massive intellectual fecundity. It was on 26th May 1999. Manchester United came from a one-goal disadvantage. They came from a one-goal disadvantage to win the Champions League final against Bayern Munich by a 2-1-goal margin, and they completed the incredible treble that year. For the purpose of completion, just let me explain how this happened. That electrifying match, Manchester United was still a goal down by the end of 90 minutes relegation time, but scored 2 goals within 3 minutes of extra time. That singular feat in 3 minutes changed the fortunes of that club till today. You know, on that day, I walked from the principal's lodge to the senior boys' hostel, and I was assured in my mind, beyond any iota of doubt, that dreams can be enlivened. Limitations are myths. Impossible is nothing. And most importantly, to him who believes, absolutely all things are possible. How many of you here think that you'll be better, smarter, and prospectively more successful if you are not Nigerians? If you have richer parents, if you are more talented, if you are elder or you are more intelligent? If only my parents are alive, or more endowed, some people would think. If only I was as smart as the prize winners of today. If only I was older. If only Nigeria had been more developed and still has more responsible. While there might be some altars of truth in these expressions, they represent what we consider as reasons for not doing more, justification for not becoming more, and worse still, excuses for refusing to dream more. They are the materials with which our mental prisons have been built. But I remember reading Julius reading Shakespeare's Junior Caesar in a national school there, where Brutus said that the fault, dear friends, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. Today, I've chosen to talk about stories. Stories about people, mostly as young or younger than all of us, who chose not to be underlings. Stories of people who redefined adversities, derived inspiration from problems, and demystified limitations. I'll situate the stories within what I have framed as the three myths, and I'll also propose practical ways you can demystify these myths. So what are myths? A myth is an untrue, untested, and unproven, or widely held belief, which has been deemed as true for a long time. For example, you might have heard that lightning never strikes the same place twice. Bulls become angry at the color red, and bats are blind. But they are untrue. Lightning certainly strikes the same place twice. In fact, on multiple occasions, bulls are colorblind, and bats are not blind. How then do they become accepted as facts? One person observes once or a few times that lightning did not occur repeatedly at a specific place. A bull charged at a matador waving a red cloth and bats and flying eat walls, and that person generalizes that such a situation applies to every situation. Joseph Goebbels, Hitler's propagandist, reportedly said, if you repeat a lie often enough, people would believe it, and you would even come to believe it yourself. This is how things are made. Even the myths of limitation, we have over time tied ourselves to limitations bordering on people, place, and time. But they are definitely, definitely untrue. I've come today to dispel every shadow of doubt about the untruths you might have believed. In respect of your potentials, I came here believing, borrowing Obama's popularized refrain, yes, you can. Yes, you can get past the barriers set by your past or the restraints of today. You can rise beyond them one. You can rise beyond whatever anybody has said about you or whatever you think about yourself. You can overcome your fears. You can overcome the seemingly impossible and improbable dreams that you have. I came here believing that, yes, we all can. So let's go down to the fundamentals of these myths that I have categorized into people, place, and time. The myth about people. The first thing is this: if it has not been done by people, then it cannot be done. The second is that those who give negative assessments of your potentials know what they are talking about, so you believe them. But neither of them is true. The conclusion of people about what can or cannot be done is a function of how far they are willing to see, dare, or push. They make their successes the farthest anyone can attain and see their failures as a natural boundary that no one can go past. I mean, to the glory of God, I became SN at 35 years, going on 36. I certainly do not pray that I will forever be the youngest SN in Nigeria. It's my prayer that someday we'll be celebrating another alumni of Olashoye International School who has achieved the first time in Nigeria. And it is possible. People make their past experiences the test of the doable and the undoable, the achievable and the unachievable. They tell me it's not possible because they failed at it. But past achievements are only proof that more achievements are possible. Past failures indicate that one more thing has not been done. This is how people innovate. They push from frontiers of what has been done previously and consider new ways to achieve what was previously considered impossible. You must have heard of Thomas Edison, the inventor of the light bulb. How many times he failed before perfecting it? The only problem with that story is that Edison did not in actual fact invent the light bulb. Years before Edison,
that experiments with light bulb, his predecessors were unable to develop resistant, durable, and commercially viable light bulbs. But it was not limited by the failures of his predecessors. He did not think that it could not be done. He started from where he stopped, went past it, searched for knowledge, searched for a path through the wall, and he went through that path. It took him roughly a decade and numerous failures to finally achieve the feat of producing the carbon filament light bulb as we currently know it today. But what he did not listen to were people who said it could not be done. So, when you hear people telling you that it is impossible, what you should simply do is close your mind, seal your heart to them. There's a virtue in the vice called stubbornness. If it is positively deployed, you must learn to be positively stubborn. Let the expressions of the impossible and the unattainable be your fuel for inspiration. Now, the other dimension of this myth is that negative assessments of other people about your prospects are true, or that they even know what they're saying.
Have you ever been told that you are too dumb to succeed? Have you ever been told that you are too slow to prosper, or that you are stupid to thrive? Well, if you've been told these things, you are probably in good company. Walt Disney got fired from his first newspaper job for lacking imagination and having no good ideas. Thomas Edison was told that he was too stupid to learn anything. Of course, Albert Einstein was described as slow because he was unable to speak fluently until he was 9 years old. I know that while most of these words barely mean anything when they are spoken, because they are usually spoken in the heat of the moment, but to the people that these words are spoken to, these words stick. Now and then, you remember the voice of the person who has said to you that you are stupid. You remember the voice of the person who has said to you that you cannot make anything good out of life. But trust me, that is untrue. No one, absolutely no one, has the right to tell you what you will be or what you will not be. You must therefore learn the act, and the act of selective listening. Selective listening is deliberately about shutting out the noise of the crowd and listening to a single speaker, which usually should be you. So, the next time someone says anything negative about your future, mentally delete those words and say to yourself, this is it. I will write and design the story of my life in partnership with God. Now, what is the next myth? Which is the myth of place? Very popular myth. The idea that where you were born, the country you live, the school you attend, can limit what you become in life. Well, this is untrue. But it might be true only to the extent that you are willing to use your location as an excuse for not dreaming more and becoming better. While the body might temporarily be limited to a particular place, the mind has the liberty, absolute liberty, to go as far as it wants to go and dream as much as it wants to. And that is where it begins, your mind. You only go as far as your mind can see. And this in part is why we read through the pages of books. We go to places we've never been, engage people we've never met, relate with ideas beyond our sphere, and expose ourselves to reasoning different from our norms. Mahatma Gandhi noted, you can change, you can touch on, you can even destroy this body, but you will never imprison my mind. So it does not matter that you are born in Malaysia or that you are schooling in local Malaysia. You can become more successful than a child born in London, New York, or Paris. You might. There might be first world countries and third world countries, but there is no default first world or third world mind. And I'll give you an example that I'm sure most of you know.
There was a certain man of Iloko origin. His parentage was Iloko, born in Elisha. But he eventually went on to become Director of Banking Supervision, Central Bank of Nigeria, became Managing Director, Afri Bank, became Managing Director, First Bank, biggest bank in Nigeria, from roots in Elisha, became Federal Minister of Finance. He was the first Nigerian banker to win the award of Banker of the Year. Who am I talking about? Sorry to my friends, so you follow Shadi. Elisha probably was not on the map at that point. So, you can't be first. You should have a first world man. There's the story of a girl born in a not so known village in a third world country, which was and is still struggling with poverty, insecurity, and terrorism. At age 11, religious extremists stopped her. Another girl from my age from going to school, insisting that only boys should be educated. At age 15, she started crusading and fighting for the rights of girls to go to school, despite the danger surrounding her. Soon after, she was shot. She had to go through months of surgeries and rehabilitation. But this did not stop Malala Yousafzai. The fact that her country, Pakistan, is a third world country, and her village is even less than a town, did not stop her from dreaming, did not stop her from acting. The fear induced by her environment did not stop her from acting, neither did the fear that she was attacked halt her from pursuing that which she dreamt about. Instead, she got up from her sickbed and she did more. Today, Malala is the youngest Nobel laureate. She travels around the globe, meets world leaders and captains of industry, advocating for girls. But not. Malala was not born in New York. She was not born in London. She was not born with a proverbial silver spoon or raised with velvet swaddled clothes. She simply rose above the assumed limitations of where she was born and converted the difficulties others would point to as limitations into opportunities through which she succeeded and impacted the lives of many. Now, I've given so many other examples, I've also circulated this paper. But I'll conclude on this note by saying that the locational challenges of where you are or the place you're growing, depending on how you interpret it, might be the edge you'd actually have over kids in developed countries. Have you heard of the story of five Nigerian schoolgirls who won the Junior Gold Award for the 2018 Technovation World Challenge? Have you looked at the numerous success stories of other Shorey students and alumni? Did you pay attention to the fantastic rendition from the choir today, or were you just carried away by their melodious voices? If you had paid attention to the lyrics, you would have found out that the message that was being passed on, as if we were working, our minds were working together in sync. In any event, it must work together because we're all products of Olajide. Certainly,
not synonymous with negative stubbornness or irresponsibility. This misimpression can be created about your young age that there's plenty of time in the future for you to do something meaningful with your life. So for the minute, just enjoy the pleasures of youth. At the end, being young explains all matters. But these myths are untrue. Events around the world prove this. Young people are getting more and more involved. I mean, there's the story of Mikaela Ullman, the 13-year-old CEO of Me and the Beast Lemonade, a business which she started at age 4 when she made lemonade using her great grandma's recipe and submitted it at a children's business fair. Oh yes, and she ended up employing her father. Quoting Mikaela, she said, "You are never too young to start something. You're never too young to contribute to society, innovate, or aim high." From personal example, my own doors and the doors of numerous alumni of this great school are examples. Considering that it is not widespread, that society generally does not expect much from the young, so special attention and interest is given to a child or teenager who breaks the age barrier and dares to be exceptional. I've given so many other examples, Michael Jordan, Stevie Wonder. But trust me, a myth is only as powerful as you make it. How powerful have you made the myths in your mind? It is time to demystify them. And I've suggested a couple of ways to you. It begins with your mind. Permit your mind to dream big. Write down your dream. Imagine ways you can achieve your dream. And then write them down. Write down the ways. And begin to work on them. Remember, you are not too young. Remember what I said about selective listening. Never listen to anyone who says that your dreams are unachievable or that you cannot succeed. Rather than being discouraged and dispirited, be positively stubborn. Do not just read to pass. When you read, ask the questions why. When you see a problem, do not complain. Instead, task your mind and develop a solution. In this way, you will imbibe the mindset of a solution creator. Never doubt your potential to become everything God has designed you to be. You are wonderfully made. It does not matter that you have failed before, or your grades are low, or your parents have certain limitations, or you have been told negative things. These things do not matter. Say to yourself, I am brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous. You are born to manifest the glory of God within you. Let your light shine and do not give other people the permission to drive you to failure. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope I've been able to deliver a message that resonates. Who are not yet prize winners, but are potential prize winners waiting in the wings. To the prize winners, please remember that excellence has no upper limit. You can always outdo what you have done today. You can redefine success on your own terms. You can exceed the expectations of what is considered to be the best. To those who are not yet prize winners, determined to give the prize winners a very healthy and honest chase from next step. Do not cut corners in your quest to excel, as this leads to shame and disgrace. Even if you don't end up as prize winners, you will hold your heads up high
as I've been given the prize winners. Very good competition. The prize winners of next year will also appreciate that you are up against very worthy and eminent competitors. Please, there is no limit to the intensity of the mind. So stretch your minds, stretch your capabilities, demand more from yourselves. Do away with distractions as much as possible. Focus on the likelihood of a very bright future, which your firm foundation from OIS supports. I've quoted Berenson, and this was what he said, in trying to give a mathematical or scientific formula to performance. He said, your performance is equal to your potential less interference. In other words, if you're able to identify, reduce, or eliminate interference, you get a closer relationship between potential and performance. Remember again, nothing is impossible. Finally, let me just cast your mind back to not too distant future. The grounds where Olashe International School currently occupies was bushland, a thick forest, and probably an assemblage of all sorts of wild animals. I don't want to scare you to talk of other people that were assembling there. But human beings such as us will not have ventured to reside there. But it took the vision of one man to envisage that this could be an idyllic setting for a citadel of knowledge in an eventual or otherwise rustic environment. Today, nobody remembers that. But if a little over 20 decades ago, this place was thick bush. Some of us sojourned from GS1 to SS3. And even during the early days, our parents kept us here, saying we should attend midterm courses. Well, we thought they were wicked then, but we're the better for it today. OIS has put a once pushing has now put local education on the map of the world with alumni imprint in different continents and world-class students who are being trained as leaders of tomorrow. Ladies and gentlemen, I implore you all to please hold firm to God, be unshaken in your faith that He has given every one of us unique capacities to excel. Remember the two irreversible truths that I've said to you today, that impossibility is nothing, and to him who believes, nothing shall be possible. Thank you.